Panthers, Carolina, and coach Matt Rhule had high praise for Dak Prescott, comparing him to all-time legends Peyton Manning and Drew Brees in terms of how he's operating the offense these days. So, Shannon, on a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you believe that Rhule believes what he's saying?
1. Mm. Now he's Peyton Manning, huh? Now he's Drew Brees. Mm. He could have just said, you know what, considering he had a career-threatening injury, Dak is playing at the top of his game. He's as good as I've seen him play, and left it there. But no, it's just like we're in basketball. This guy's the next Kobe Bryant. This guy's the next it's not good enough for the guy to be, oh, he's playing unbelievable. Mm. That's not good enough. We got to go to the highest of highs. We got to do the hyperbole to the 18th percent. Why we just can't say Dak is playing really good. Mm. He had a serious injury last year. He looks comfortable in the pocket. They've done a great job of surrounding him with talent. Offensive line to protect him. He's doing a great job of getting the ball out of his hand. Mm-hmm. Oh, my goodness. He's playing unbelievable. But no, that's not good enough. We can't do that. Mm. That's not good enough. We got to go to the highest power. Mm. No, that's a 1. I'm giving him a 1. So that guy, he's high completion percentage, but he's digging and dacking. He's 14th in yards per attempt. Way down at the bottom and throws over 20 yards. Mm. Way down. So stop this.
Okay, I give this a 0 in credibility.
Okay.
0. But I do believe there's method to the madness. Because remember, the distinction here is he's not saying Dak is Peyton Manning or Drew Brees as a thrower of the football.
No.
He's talking about the way he calls the game at the line of scrimmage, that it's equal to Peyton or Brees, as in pre-snap, checkoffs, audibles, whatever you want to call them, that he's controlling the game before the snap. Well, the truth is, I don't love it when Dak controls the game before the snap because sometimes they think themselves into oblivion. It's analysis by paralysis.
He gets pass happy, huh?
Well, and he gets pass happy. What did we hear on opening night after opening night at Tampa Bay?
Right.
What happened? Dak threw 58 passes that night. That's a lot of passes.
That's a lot of passes.
They ran it a grand total of 18 times. And after the game, Kellen Moore went on the record to point out, defending himself,
right,
I called 28 runs in the game, but only 18 times we ran because he checked out of 10 runs. Mm-hmm. So 10 times, his best friend Zeke is going to get the sugar. It might have been Pollard a couple of times, but mostly it'd be Zeke.
Somebody was going to get the ball other than CeeDee Lamb.
Right? And again, Dak checked out of it.
Right.
I don't like it when Dak is checking and checking and the clock's going down 3-2-1 and there's a snap and it's high and it's wild from the kid center to Biotis. Can't block anybody and sometimes he can't snap it. And so I don't love that chaos at the snap. I also don't love this team when Dak throws 58 passes because my favorite all-time stat, Dallas Cowboys stat, under Dak Prescott, they are 26-0. That's a staggering stat.
Right.
When they run it more than they throw it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what did we just see at Chargers and against Philly? They ran it down their throats. Mm-hmm. They have risen all the way up to 4th in rushing. Guess what Carolina does better than anybody? They stop the run. Mm-hmm. This is a clash of strengths because Carolina is now averaging a grand total of 45 rush yards allowed per game.
Right.
They're holding their opponents to 45 rush yards. Kamara in that wipeout at Carolina, mm-hmm, for the Saints, obviously, Kamara went 8 times for a grand total of 5 yards. He's going backwards.
Right.
He can't even get out of the block.
Right. I think the thing is, and also, Skip, when we look at this, and the Saints, we think the Saints can be good, can be a playoff team. The other two teams, I think they played the Jets, and I think they played the Texans, which aren't very good teams. They jump out to big leads. Now they take your run game out of it. I think Dallas is going
to
be
saying, to a certain extent.
I think Dallas is going to say, you know what? We're going to be patient. We're going to be here for a while. We bought some Snicker bars, so we're going to be here for a while.
Okay,
so
I always tell you about the Emmitt Smith Cowboys, and I know I'm going to the highest dynastic level, but they did not care what you did. You could put 12 men in the box. Emmitt is going to get the football.
Yeah, Emmitt's
going to
get it.
Much often to Troy's chagrin, because Troy could throw it. Oh, yeah. He was a dart thrower.
Well, Troy was pinpoint accurate.
Okay, pinpoint accurate, but if you look at his numbers, historic numbers, they're pedestrian at best. If you didn't know any better, if you didn't know the outcomes of the season, you'd look at Troy's number and say, there's no way he should be in the Hall of Fame, except he has three rings.
Right.
That should be five.
Troy, I don't think anybody wishes they could play more in this era than Troy.
Yeah.
Because they could to be able to throw the ball and the accuracy in which he threw it with, he threw Mike Irvin open. He threw those guys open, the Novacheks and the Alvin Harper, Skip. So now he's like, hold on. Y'all realize I was quarterback and just turn around and hand the ball off to the all-time lead rusher. Yeah. So how many passes did you think I was going to throw with Emmy getting 25, 30 carries a game?
Exactly. And I've never heard this from Troy, but I'm guessing his all-time favorite individual game was the NFC Championship game that they lost at Candlestick Park against the Niners, the Steve Young year, because Deion was on the other side and Troy got off to a rocky start. They got off to a rocky start, and they look up, and they're down 21 to nothing. And Troy's like, okay, here I go.
I got it,
I got 88 against 21.
Right.
Deion Sanders.
And Skip, if you
and
go
I'm
back
gonna throw it to 88 all day long.
Go back and look at that first Super Bowl in the Rose Bowl.
Yeah.
He threw a party on Buffalo.
No, he did. They just knew they were better.
He threw a party.
Buffalo. No, I got it. So the point is that I think Matt Rhule is trying to encourage Dak to go pass happy.
Yeah, throw it.
Now they lost J.C. Horn, but again, that they think they have a better chance of beating Dallas at Dallas if he's just winging it 58 times all over the lot, because that's not who they should be. And if he goes pass happy by audibling out of runs at the line of scrimmage, they'll have a chance. If they start to hammer away with both Zeke and Pollard, because they sort of found themselves. This is their new identity, and it's the, guess what? It's the magic recipe.
Well, Skip, you know, you might be onto something, and Troy might be onto something. If you're going to tell me they're going to have, say, 60 plays, and 30 of them's going to be rush, and 30 of them's going to be pass, and you're going to get somewhere between 130 and 160 rush yards, and Dak's going to throw somewhere between 245 and 285.
Magic ingredients.
Well, now I'm gonna be sick a lot of Monday mornings coming in here.
You are, and I just hope Matt Rhule is sick on Sunday night as he flies back to Carolina.
I'm hoping that's not the case.
Because I hope we run on the best run defense for a real cool 150.
Well, here's the thing, though, Skip. They get after the quarterback. I think they're leading the league in sacks.
And
they get after the quarterback, but it's going to be interesting to see how they...
Yeah, let's just hammer away.
Oh, now you back in love with the run now.
Yep, I am. We're the new Dallas Cowboys.
Oh, you go new Cowboys going back to the old Cowboys.
How about the run game? The Patriots' loss to the Eagles in Super Bowl 52 was just why Pro Bowl corner Malcolm Butler never played a defensive snap. Well, a new book on the Patriots details that Butler had a heated exchange with defensive coordinator Matt Patricia that led to his infamous benching. Does that make sense, Shannon? What do you make of this?
It still does not justify him not playing in the game. Mm. Unless he whipped Matt Patricia's ass and they escorted him to jail. And if I'm Coach Belichick, I bond him out. Are you playing in this game?
I agree.
This doesn't justify him not playing. I don't care how contentious the argument got, Skip. There is no justification other than the arrogance of Coach Bill Belichick believing that Malcolm Butler is just another cog and we can win this game without him. That's all that was, Skip. As I mentioned before, Malcolm Butler got his start because Kyle Arrington, that was the DB, Skip, that was getting cooked that game.
He was.
And Coach Belichick inserted Malcolm Butler.
Yep.
And you see, Skip, that's what he did. Oh, who else would have done that? Kyle Arrington's making $7 to $8 million a year. An undrafted rookie gets inserted into the game. That's the genius. But see, Skip, what happens, you start getting high on your own supply.
Yep.
You start believing that, it's me. I'm doing this.
Yep.
And like, nah, you're not playing. And it ended up possibly costing him or his team a great chance at winning. That's what this all was. Because I've seen it before. I played 14 years. And I've seen coaches and players almost come to blows. And ain't nobody didn't play the next game. As a matter of fact, they go back in the next series. Because it happened on the sideline, Skip. Practice? We're talking about, because he got into an argument at practice. Who in the hell haven't gotten into an argument with a coach at practice?
Mm.
And then that's the Super Bowl. Nah, you tried. You're going to make it. That's the game that you're going to choose. I'm going to put my foot down and show y'all I'm Lead Foot Bill.
I once witnessed on Monday Night Football a teammate of yours, a white guy named Bill Romanowski, spit on a black player named J.J. Stokes. Spit on him right in the middle of Monday Night Football.
Exactly.
And you guys went, you figured it out.
Figured it out.
Right?
Yes.
And you went forward, and Bill did not miss any games.
Didn't miss any games,
And guess what you did? You went and you won the Super Bowl.
Skip, I can't imagine a scenario in which a player does something that he's not incarcerated. Because if you look at the night before the Super Bowl, Eugene Robinson, he got arrested. He played in the game.
He did.
He got arrested. You talking about you going to bench a player for an argument, a disagreement, a contentious disagreement with a coach, and you're not going to let him play?